Hi, welcome to Artists in Residences, the Westport Library's virtual artist series. I'm Carol Ergerfass, and I'm the exhibit curator at the library. Today, Migs Burrows interviews sculptor Niki Ketchman. Niki works with a combination of industrial and domestic materials, from chicken wire to rose petals, often incorporating weaving, sewing, and more recently, inkjet printing, to create a world where art, craft, and design intersect. Her work could be large and outdoors, or it could be small enough to sit on a tabletop. It could be soft or hard, leaned on or walked into, blurring the lines between sculpture, toys, and furniture. Niki's resume lists over 100 exhibitions and galleries and museums around the Northeast. But since we can't travel now, we're lucky to be able to visit her in her studio, where she'll show us some of her work and let us know what she's been up to.
Thanks, Carol. And this is a pleasure. I have been to Niki's studio, full disclosure, in the past on a studio tour when we could do such things. But I think I'll probably see more this way, actually. And she's going to go outside and show us some of her sculptures. They're almost like living things, so they're incredible. They use, like you said, from rose petals to wire to many materials used in very innovative ways. So, hello, Niki. Why don't we just start off with you showing us around?
Welcome to my studio. I want to thank Migs and Carol for inviting me, and my husband Jeff for doing this video. I'm going to start by telling you how I began to be a sculptor. My master's degree is in painting, and I painted for 15 years. And then one day, going to various exhibitions in the city, I saw a Martin Perrier show, and I started to wonder what it would be like just to draw a shape. And I had a little sketch pad with me, 4 inches by 6 inches, which I carried on the train to try to sketch people. And so These are two of the very little drawings that I made. So after I brought these home and showed them to my husband, he said, "Why don't you make them a little bigger?" So I did, but my process was to just scribble with my mind totally blank. And within the scribble, sometimes I would see a shape that seemed meaningful for some unexplainable reason. And when I did, I then made it larger and worked on it till it was pleasing to me. The idea was not to do something that was beautiful, but do something that had some emotional reaction from me. After doing many of these, I decided to try to build one, and so began my time as a sculptor. That was 1988. I'm going to show you the first sculpture outdoors, and you can see how it imitated the ink line. This is my sculpture souvenir, and as you can see, the surface is a squiggly black line, which is made of wire, and that wire was imitating the scribbled ink line. Inside is a red bamboo stick. That's the souvenir. That's the title. And I've made it more dense on some sides than on others, so that it's like a window where you see the souvenir. The titles always come after the sculpture. It's not that I start to make something with an idea in mind. It's just I start out making a drawing, and then whatever emerges. And then I think of what was it I was trying to say. Moving on, I can show you my sculpture Laced. This sculpture was part of my show at the DeCordova Museum and Sculpture Park, and it was on the cover of the brochure. That show was up for a whole year with 8 outdoor sculptures. That was 1998 to 99.
The whole surface is the same woven aluminum wire. And the lace is made of bungee cord. Now I have a little bit of humor in this sculpture in that I think of it as a cross between the old lady in the shoe and a corset. Our third sculpture afterwards here. This is my sculpture pied-à-terre, and this was in the Sculpture Biennial, Neuberger Museum, and it was out in the field. And my idea was to have three places where one can sit, very sturdy, four places where one can sit. You can face one of each one's facing a different direction, and each one has a different kind of decoration. The structure on the sides and the seats are all woven aluminum wire with steel rods inside. And this is stenciled flowers on aluminum screening. This side has macrame PVC over a very durable outdoor fabric. And this side is made with two layers of screening. The top layer is black, the inside is silver, and sort of ripped it apart to make holes in it so that it has two layers. And the last side is the gathered fabric with buttons sewed on. So you can hang out at your pied-à-terre in four different kinds of atmospheres. Now we can go inside and I'll show you some more work. This is my studio, and you can see on the right wall there all the materials, various paints, wires, beads, all kinds of different materials that I use in my sculptures. And sometimes the inspiration from a sculpture has to do with finding a material that I like. This is my sculpture zipped. This is the surface is the same aluminum wire that I weaved over the whole thing. And often my outdoor sculptures are considered feminine looking because they're delicate compared to the big metal sculptures with large iron beams or steel beams. And mine are just very handmade, and that's what I do with all my sculptures. I weave, I wind, I decorate, and I like using the small wire and going over every inch. It's just part of my personality. When I painted, I used to go over everything with a size zero brush. And this way I go over every little bit with a wire. And this piece called Zipped is also a little bit humorous in that I think of it as a combination of a dress and a condom. The zipper goes up over the top and down the other side, making it kind of useless. The next sculpture I'm going to show you is Dorothy's Secret Garden. I was a Weir Farm resident, and I made three sculptures, each having to do with one of the daughters who grew up on Weir Farm. And Dorothy's Secret Garden was a garden that's what they called it, because she let it get so overgrown that you couldn't see it. So the exterior of this sculpture looks like either a bush or a skirt, but you don't really see a garden until you go around it and go inside. If you go inside, then you see all the flowers, which are the hidden garden. I might add that some of my sculptures in here are on wheels or on bases because it's a way of being able to move them around the studio. It's not part of the sculpture. Behind us is the sculpture called Mounds. This was in the same show as Laced at the Decorative Museum, the Sculpture Park. And it's my interpretation of Mother Earth. As I said, the dollies that they're on are not part of the sculpture. This is a 1950s breast, pink flowers, pink and yellow flowers, and this is 1960s macrame. Next is one of my sculptures that's part of one of my ongoing series. And that ongoing series is the rose series. The rose, why the rose? Well, the rose can be a symbol or associated with all kinds of things, such as romance, fragrance, beauty, pageantry, ceremonies, even death and war. This sculpture got a little out of hand because it has 15,000 roses on it. I bought them a couple of dozen at a time, dried them, and dipped them in something called Pavropol, which looks milky but dries to a clear plastic. And I put them I inserted them into the steel and fencing structure that I made so that all the blossoms are on the outside and all the thorny stems are on the inside. So when you walk into this, it feels kind of ominous. It's not a place you really want to hang out. And that was part of my idea, to make the inside a little bit scary and the outside peaceful, calm, and beautiful. Another sculpture in the Rose series is the Bed of Roses. And this is another sculpture that is a little bit interactive. When I can, I like to make the sculptures available for use in a more than just visually. And this sculpture is called A Bed of Roses because this looks like an image of a bed with an impression of a person. It's actually a digital print. It's actually a digital print on canvas, which is then glued onto a sheet of aluminum. I actually took many photographs of roses, put them together in Photoshop, put in the shadow, and then mounted it. And if you stand here, you can lean back and be in the bed of roses. The back of the bed of roses are all silk rose petals. Now we're going to go upstairs and look at a few more sculptures. This is my sculpture comforter. And it's a pedestal with a Greek sculpture on top. Actually, it's a pillow, but it's an image of the Greek sculpture Aphrodite, the goddess of love and comfort. And I printed it on both sides. This side has the same image, but in different colors. The pedestal is woven on the surface with the same aluminum wire as the other sculptures. Along with this is, I made some digital prints with this whole series. This is part of my series called Sculpture for Home Use, because the sculptures sort of cross the boundaries between sculpture, toys, and furniture. The image called Maya and Marge, which Migs is going to show you right now, is a big digital print, and you can see that an old lady who was my mother, who was 93, is laying next to a little baby, who is my granddaughter. So it was her great-granddaughter, Maya, who was 3 months old. Actually, they were photographed in two different places. My mother was photographed in the nursing home and Maya at her home. And I put them together on the computer. So the next sculpture in the same series, same sculpture for home use series, is called Intent. And this has stainless steel rods and layers of fabric. I layered the fabric, it's actually fiberglass screening with two different colors of fabric underneath. And because the screening is translucent with a grid, it creates a terrific moire pattern. This part has only one piece of fabric under the screening, so the moire pattern looks a little bit different. It's called Intent because you can get in the tent. And the idea is to have somebody sitting on the floor, leaning on each side, and in this image that Mix is showing you is another digital print that I made, where the three of them are on their laptops, the baby on a toy laptop in front of the fireplace, which is a comment on society. Instead of sitting in front of the fireplace reading books, they're each on their laptops. And another third sculpture in the same series is called Safekeeping. This sculpture you can see has zippers on the surface and fabric that has a bucolic scene, all looking peaceful and nice. A little bit of pink fur screening. This is a fringe made out of the zippers. However, each of these zippers unzips, revealing a pocket. And in these pockets, you can put your treasures and zip them back up. And I made it on wheels so you can take your treasures with you. Of course, this implies that there's something that you have to keep your treasures safe from. So the world outside is not as safe as you might think. So this is another one of my sculptures for home use. Now we can go back to, oh, and as we're going down, you can see a few of my other earlier sculptures, all of which were imitating that drawn line with wire that is curled around and around and around. Oh, do you want to look at these sculptures over here? Were part of a show that I had at Corus Gallery. It was my gallery for 10 years, and I had a full one-person shows during those years. And this show was called Primal Fugue. I made all the sculptures based on the cylinder, just to see how many varieties I could get. Because there were many varieties of the same shape, I called it a fugue, and cylinder being the primal shape. If you look out the window, you can see a top-down view of Piena Air. Okay, we're going to go back downstairs now and look at a few more things. These are my resonations, I call them. I call them resonations because they are covered with resin, coated with resin. Each one is done differently, and I find that throughout all the years when I've been working on sculptures, it's nice to do some two-dimensional work because the sculptures, as you can see, are very labor-intensive and take a lot of physical effort. So it's a nice respite to do something that's just intuitive, that I have no plan on, just like the drawings that I did earlier. I can show you two recent ones and show you two different approaches. Each one is approached differently. This one was actually a necklace that had started to come apart, and we spread it out on a glass table we have in the kitchen. These are reflections in the glass of the lights that are above. We have a multicolored lighting fixture, and I added a few bits of scrape paint. I also added a chain that looks very much like the chain in the necklace. And printed it out using the computer in Photoshop, and then poured resin over it. The resin makes it more of an object, and the whole idea behind these is sort of an investigation of actual depth as opposed to illusionistic depth. This one was the most recent one that I did, and this I had a totally different approach. I took liquid acrylics, poured a bunch of colors into a cup. Well, first I painted the canvas black, and then turned the cup upside down, slammed it down on the canvas, the paint poured out, and then I tilted the canvas in different directions and let it spread out, and got this very dramatic looking image. Then I saw this beautiful blue, and happened to have quite a few beads of that color. So I added those to add more dimension, and then again coated it by pouring resin over the whole thing. Okay, we'll now move on to the cafe, where I have some other sculptures and digital images. On the floor here is a sculpture called Snake in the Grass. It's fabric and stuffed, like a stuffed animal, and the light green fringe is the grass. If you unzip this, you could empty out the entire thing, turn it inside out, and it becomes an ottoman like this. This is also part of my sculpture for home use series, having a little fun. This is my grandson playing on the snake. And then this is my daughter on it in the other form, the ottoman form. She was pregnant, and so that gives a new meaning to the word snake in the grass. And this is the most recent contribution to my sculpture for home use. I made this in 2017. It's called Staggering. And the reason it's called staggering is because the cubes from which it's made are staggered. And I thought it was a good play on words. Now this can be rearranged in about a dozen different ways. One way, for instance, and you could sit on it. These surfaces are all covered with leather that I hand sewed together. And then these surfaces are lambskin scraps, which I also sewed together. I can show you one more, how this goes together in all so many different ways. This way it can be two seats. A place to rest your arm. However, you can really see all the iterations in this short video that Mix is now going to play for you.
We were just kids when we fell in love, not knowing what it was. I will not give you up this time. Darling, just kiss me. Your heart is all I own, and in your eyes, you're holding mine.
Behind that is another image which was part of my rose series. And this is a path made of rose petals. The scene has an invented light and has been modified. I took about 16 photographs, because I don't have a large format camera, and pieced them together in Photoshop. This is the Barrens North. So I got rid of the fence, the dogs, the people, and just made this mysterious scene. It can be seen, it's a little hard to see it here because there's so much reflection, but Mix has an image that he can show you without the reflection. It's because it's mounted behind plexiglass that it's so reflective. And over here is another addition to the Rose series, my latest one, and this is called
No one promised you a rose garden. On this side are beautiful roses. But if you come around and look at the other side, things don't look quite as pleasant. And my idea was to have something that's in full bloom, full of life, and then gradually have it overtaken by these red drips, blood-like drips, that make you think of maybe death. And lastly, the sculpture I've done while sheltering in place is my reaction to the coronavirus. And this is called Exposed. And this top part, the top part is made of resin. I'm going to turn out the light behind it because it's easier to see it and see the macrame. It's made of resin, which I poured into a mold that I made of aluminum foil and put it together on a surface and then macrameed the whole bottom part. The macrameed part, to me, is kind of a shelter, or like a robe or a tent or anything that's protective. But as you can see, the resin shards stick out from it and are exposed. This is showing no matter how hard you try, you might still end up getting the coronavirus. So to sum up, I guess that's all I'll show you right now. I'd like to just say that why make this art? You might wonder why make it. I certainly have enough of it. It seems to be an enduring interest to make something from nothing. And as a way of expressing feelings, what I see and what I think in a visual way, and hope that maybe some viewers will relate to it and have those feelings that they can see in a way that they hadn't seen before. So thank you again for inviting me, and that is the conclusion of my studio tour.
Well, thank you so much, Niki. I had so many questions to ask, and had I asked them all, you probably would have only gotten to show two or three things. So I'm glad we did it the way we did, just to explain to the audience. The signal wasn't good enough in your studio to do a live Zoom, so you pre-recorded it, and it came out great. Thanks to Jeff, who did the recording. And it's just phenomenal. The materials, the concepts, the handwork, the artistry, and the craftsmanship as well, just astounding. So thanks very much, and back to Carol.
Oh, thank you so much, Niki. It was so cool to see what your studio looks like and also some of the sculptures that you have around your home. So to wrap up, for more information about all things about the library, please check out westportlibrary.org. Thanks, and hope to see you there soon.